Good evening, folks.
Good evening.
Welcome to another lecture presented to you by members of the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. So this school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious scientific research organization dedicated to ensuring proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kingman, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. We hold classes in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. In this school, we use the true, correct, original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit that are found in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh, improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim, improperly substituted with God. The true name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of the physical body, is Yahshua, erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and God many. We now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title, which means Elohim is a title the Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part, any good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither in the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language were there letters or characters that could produce the sound of this letter J. Neither was this J in the English language for some 1,400 years after the death of the Messiah, making names such as Jesus and Jehovah impossible renderings of the original name of the Father or the Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this pure spirit state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no distinctive shape or form. We have drawn the cloud all the way around the edges of the chart to show you that everything on the chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive him in this pure spirit state, took on a shape and took on a form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, the state and form of a man without flesh or blood. In this state, he can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself into a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior while he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Millennium Bible. Also in this school, we teach according to a divine pattern. We call it a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. The 10 primary objectives and aims of the Institute are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity within Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. 5, to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and angels. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, and Satan and his demons, operating in the spirit of iniquity on earth through the dispensations and time of time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith that was once delivered under the sons and children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men in which man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in a new earth state. Our watchword is peace and our slogan is speak the truth. Our scripture tonight is Hebrews 9th chapter. Announce hospitality, call on Dr. Diana Smith, and to dedicate the class in prayer, I'd like to call on Dr. Justin Snyder from the Art Court.
Evening class, take this opportunity to bow our hearts and our minds to Yahweh through Yahshua and just ask that he take care of the cares of the world, that we can leave those things outside the door and focus on the things that are being presented from the floor. Be ever thankful that he has delivered this vision unto mankind and invited us down here and given us a way to know him for a surety through a simple understanding, simple purpose, pattern, and plan of salvation for that work. I can't say enough, but hallelujah.
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 I'll be reading tonight's scripture out of a Leaning Bible, Hebrews 9th chapter. Then verily, the first covenant had also orders of service and a worldly sanctuary. For in the first compartment of the tabernacle were the candlestick, the table, and the showbread, which is called the holy place. And beyond the veil, the second compartment of the tabernacle, which is called the Holy of Holies, which had the golden censer and the Ark of the Covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that hid manna, and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant. And over it the cherubim of glory, shadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly. Now when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service. But into the second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. The Holy Spirit signifying this, that the way into the Holy of Holies was not yet made manifest, while the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices, that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience. which stood only in meal and drink offerings and various washings and cardinal ordinances imposed on them unto the time of Reformation. But the Messiah, being a high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of a heifer, sprinkling of unclean, sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Yahshua, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to the Holy, the Most High, purge your conscience from death-causing works to serve the living element. And for this purpose, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of transgressions of the First Testament, those which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where a covenant is, there must also of necessity be the death of that which ratifies. For a covenant is made firm over the death of the victim. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all, while that which ratifies is alive. Whereupon neither the first covenant was confirmed without blood. For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water and sacred scarlet wood and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant which Yahweh hath enjoined unto you." Moreover, he sprinkled likewise with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these. But the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For the Messiah is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of Yahweh for us, nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entered into the holy place every year with other blood. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now, once in the end of the age, hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. So the Messiah was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time, without sin offering unto salvation. That's Hebrews 9th chapter.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight to support this class. It's important for us to be here. I'd also like to thank, from our art part class, visiting members. We have Dr. Bonnie Snyder, the dean. Thank you very much for coming out. Also, class members, Dr. Justin Snyder, thank you for coming out with us. We also have from our Ontario, California class visiting with us today, we have Dr. Will Williams, Dr. Benjamin Williams.
From the Northside Chicago class.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Northside Chicago class.
That's my fault.
Okay, that's all right. And we also have from Ontario, California, Dr. Kiloway Punishment. Thank you so much for coming out tonight to visit with us and study. We're here and just, we're so happy to have you. It's nice. It just stirs us all up and just thank you for coming out to do this. Let's give them a warm welcome. Thank you.
home yesterday. I was hoping to be seen today. Our first speaker, I'd like to call on Dr. Benjamin Williams from the Northside Chicago.
How y'all doing?
Hello.
I'm happy to be here. Thank Yahweh, I spoke for allowing me to come and sup with brethren and talk about some things that, you know, the Holy Spirit has revealed unto all of us, you know, like his understanding, his grace and mercy, which is, you know, Yahshua the Messiah. And that was a good scripture, right? Talks about the type, you know, the sanctuary, you know, physical tabernacle. You know, where did they get this from? They got this from Moses having a divine vision of revelation from Elohim. And he sees the 7 days of creation and the 33 days, he sees the inner working of the what? Tabernacle. So that's 40 days all together. So when he comes down, they have to build one exactly like it in the wilderness. Now this tabernacle reflects the real true tabernacle, which is Yahweh Elohim. So what you see here. So he made him and Israel people that he put a spirit in, which is understanding and knowledge and wisdom, to make this tabernacle. Now, the steps of the pattern, you can go by 7 steps, but it's threefold. Most holy place, and the court roundabout, but you have one tabernacle. Why is it threefold and one? Because you got the Father, Yahweh, Elohim, the Word of the Son, and Yahshua, and these three are one. Now you got 7 steps. You got the gate, the brazen lamp, altar, sin sacrifice. Then you got the brazen laver and the door. That's the 4th step. The door, he said in the book that he was the door. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? That's a literal door that you gotta go through to get to the holy place. So if he's the door, that means what? You gotta go through Yahshua to go to the holy place. And if you have some understanding of that door, spiritually, a door is what? Physically, to go, you know, to come in, right? So, spiritually, to get in Yahshua, you got to go through the door. So, that's spiritually. So, they say, well, what do you mean, Yahshua, the door, that's spiritually, and how do you go through the door? Well, it's simple, you know. You got to start off with the basics. You know, they sacrifice what? Animals here for their sins, because Israel was saying to bring up a sacrifice, and they would sacrifice animals for their sins. And, you know, the Messiah is the atoning sacrifice. Spirit. You see him right here? He's the atoning sacrifice. 4 points of blood. Just like in Egypt, they had a door, right? It was 4 points of blood. They took the lamb out and they pierced it in the side. Just like that, the lamb got to be without spot and blemish. And they examined that out and watching that too. Now, it's a twofold function. And you can take that twofold function physically with them washing up and the sacrifice. And spiritually, he's that brazen laver too. What do that represent spiritually? He's the living water. Mm-hmm. So if he's the living water, that means what he tell us, he give us what? Living water. Mm-hmm. The words. Mm-hmm. Then the high priest was anointed with this cup of anointing oil. And he was anointed from head to toe. Mm-hmm. With all that oil poured on. So for all of you to be in the holy place. Give me that Daniel, when it says, I'm not good with scripture like that, but it says, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. But even though the priest was anointed with oil, he can officiate in the holy place. But for your journey to get to the holy place, we're going to see what Daniel has to say about it.
Now,
when you see the abomination of desolation, or in other words, when you see all this crap out here, you know, people worshiping the Mosaic law and they doing everything wickedness. When you see all this stuff on this side of the cross, when you see this stuff on this side of the cross, this is a spiritual dispensation and age. This is not, we're physically here, but it's spiritual. They took that Mosaic law and they drug it over here. And when you come to class, you see all this stuff. You like, what, you know, what's going on? You know, it'd be, you know, Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. And people tell you, you know, you don't have to worship that, you know, Mosaic law. But this is the truth. How do you not worship the Mosaic law and get into the holy place? Read.
When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet.
Now, Daniel talked about that desolation. Mm-hmm. But read.
Stand in the holy place.
Now, we got a tabernacle physically to show you that the way how the priests have to go through the here in the holy place, the same way the priests have to officiate in the holy place, that priest is a type of Yahshua the Messiah. Now, what Yahshua do with us, you know, we go through the altar. Then we get washed. Then we get anointed with his spirit, which is oil. Then we go through the door, which is Yahshua, and we in him. Now, once you in him, and you ain't dealing with the, you know, like what they say, stand in the holy place and the desolation and abomination and stuff. You got, you know, light. That light candlestick, if you look at it physically, you pour oil in it. There's 7 branches. And they start with the middle. So when you put oil in there and light it, it lights up the holy place. Then you have bread for the priest to eat off of. There's 12 loaves of bread. And he eat pretty that's the daily food. You know, give us our daily bread, but it's not like that. But in the spirit, we need to, this is that light. Or does a candlestick represent as illumination? And that's Yahshua Messiah in you. When you stand in the holy place, Dr. Kelly said you don't sit, you stand. And the way you stand is, you know, having a knowledge or some understanding of the truth of about what the holy place is. And once you have that knowledge and you truly is standing, you got light, which is illumination, you got an innocence, this altar and incense, you know, it gave a sweet smelling savior unto Yahweh, the nostrils of Yahweh. When he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, that was a sweet smelling savior unto Yahweh. Just like when you breathe your air, eat food and all that stuff, it gives a sweet smelling savior to your, you know, nostrils. And you don't smell all of that stuff in your small intestines, you know, like the sacrifice that they sacrifice. So, you know, your body goes on to this pattern. You know, the pattern represents Yahshua Messiah spiritually. And the point I'm trying to get to is this. Standing in the holy place, you have to let that stuff, worldly stuff, like the prayer said, you know, like ask Yahweh to take care of the cares of this world and let that go so you can have an understanding. Mm-hmm. Once you have an understanding about the high priest, Yahshua, the high priest, like Dr. Kelly said on the 1958 video, he said, you know, Christ or God is the high priest in our hearts and in our minds. Now, for him to be in your heart and your mind, you have to have what? An understanding of this measuring rod, which is nothing more than this tabernacle. So for you to be in the holy place, you got to go through the steps of the pattern. And it's not physical, it's all spiritual. Spiritually, you got to be, you got to accept the atoning sacrifice. Spiritually, you got to be washed. Spiritually, Yahshua himself anoints you with oil. That's his spirit in you. Then you at the door, and he invites you in into the holy place. Yahshua is the holy place, so that means you and Yahshua and Yahshua and you. Now, once you have an understanding, you got bread, you can eat his, like Dr. Kelly said, we are feeding you this bread from heaven. So once you eat that bread from heaven, you realize you're standing in the holy place. Then when you go to, you know, before the Father at the end of this age, you know, you want to be clothed in him. And that's that glorified body, you know, with the breastplate for Israel and, you know, and his garments of the splendor of glory. You want to be clothed in him. We here now. And what we hear, some people hear, you know, some people hear in the court roundabout. But you want to be here in the holy place. And when he's universally be revealed, he takes you to the Father, and you one with him. And you know, you got a glorified body. So once you have that glorified body, that's like, you know, we can say court roundabout, holy place, most holy place, you know. First step, second step, first step, the gate, second step, the brazen altar, a sin sacrifice, third step, the brazen laver, the fourth step, the door, the fifth step is what? The holy place. The sixth step is the veil. The seventh step is the most holy place. Now, we're getting ready to cross over into the what? Seventh dispensation. So you take that seven and you correlate it with the most holy place, and that's the seven. And once you do get a glorified body, Yahweh is well pleased with his son in you. But the holy place is simple to get there. It's very simple. It's not hard. All you have to do is understand it physically first and the function of it. And know that this is the high priest spiritually. This is Yahshua spiritually. And this is Yahshua spiritually. And this is Yahshua spiritually. So, you know, we just have to, you know, understand basic things like that. And, you know, make sure that, you know, the tabernacle is important. The blood, water, spirit is important. The death, burial, resurrection is important. Always keep the principles. Ask Yahweh to give you an understanding better with the death, burial, resurrection. What is that? That's Yahshua. If you understand that, you know, and the blood, water, spirit, 40, then you can understand the things on these charts, like the understanding of how all this stuff works. And you know how it works because it goes according to a divine pattern, which is Yahweh himself. That's what we come down here for. We don't come down here to hear, you know, different speakers. Like, you know, I got to hear Freddie Allen today. And you know, you listen. You come down here to hear the preaching of the gospel. Mm-hmm. And we may see certain things like, oh, he can speak well. And I want to speak like that. I want to, that was good, man. I give you all the credit, honor, and glory. It don't work that way. The one deserving credit, honor, and glory is the one that created it. And when you come down and sit in these seats, all you do is listen. That's all you have to do. And you know, and you have that discernment in you, whether if I'm telling you the truth or not, we all have that, spiritually and psychologically. Now, when it comes to that discernment, that's Yahshua the Messiah. Now, he can say, and you get an understanding, that's him. But when you come up and I'm not picking on nobody, but even though, you know, one of the head bosses of the Institute had passed away, which was Dr. Harris, he preached a lot of things against the things that Dr. Kennedy taught. And people just go with it, you're a threefold negative entity. Well, in my discernment, I know I'm not no threefold negative entity. That's my understanding that Yahshua gave me. And Dr. Kennedy said that Yahweh is spirit, and there's none else, and there's nothing co-eternal with it or coexisting with it. That's my understanding, and that's why I stick with it. He took on shape and form as Yahweh Elohim, then he manifested in the flesh as Yahshua the Messiah. That's understanding for me to know. I hold on to that. Everything that Yahweh gave me an understanding with discernment, I hold on to that. Now, you know, sometimes you deal with the devil sometimes too. And he might come up and, you know, project some thoughts with your emotion, like, you know, with the stuff with the teacher too, because he came to the Messiah, you know, with scripture. Now, if he came to Yahshua, don't think he ain't gonna come to you either. So like Dr. Kelly said, you ain't no match for him at all. You make sure you in God and God is in you. You translate that with Yahweh. You make sure you in Yahweh and Yahweh is in you. You see what I'm saying? Because you dealing with, Paul fought with beasts at Ephesus and things like that. Man, people with higher authority in this world, even in class, you got to stand in the holy place. And when you stand in the holy place, you got all the armor of Yahweh on you, or Yahshua, the breastplate of righteousness and a helmet of salvation. You got that. You can stand with the truth, and the truth cannot change. Why? Because love, intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength, Yahweh is all that, including what? Yahshua. He is truth. He can't change. So if you got that truth in you, that's what's going to abide in you, and that's what's going to defend you. That's what keeps us, is truth. Now, you have a choice. Either you accept the truth and love it, or you reject it and you move on, and the devil will snare you and get you and restore with Israel. He gave them a commandment, and he gave them choices too, with the laws too, which is that Mosaic law. He knew they couldn't keep that law, but he also gave them blessings and curses and said, if you keep my commandments, I'll bless you. If you don't, this is what's going to happen to you. So, some people kept the blessings, kept the commandments with blessings. Other ones, a multitude. You know what happened to them? They went into captivity. Yahweh put them in captivity. Why? Because of their disobedience. They didn't want to keep the commandments. And he did things to them. Why? Because they didn't want to obey what? His voice. And it comes back to what? Around the mountain. He said Israel had to come around the mountain, and Yahweh would speak. And when he thundered and spoke to the children of Israel, he basically told them, you shall have no other gods or else before me. Now, when he told them the Ten Commandment law, and Aaron and the 70 elders, Aaron, Nebai, and Abiah, and Moses, and Joshua and his minister took him up there. He took off the physical body and transfigured into a form, a superincorporeal form as Yahweh Elohim. And he sees this, and they see the Elohim of Israel, and under his feet was a paved work of a sapphire stone, and the body of heaven in his clearness. So in other words, he wasn't no white man. He wasn't no black man either. You get that? Now, Moses saw it, they saw it, but you know, what made them go down there and build a golden calf? What made them do that? It'd be stuff. He didn't what, give them an understanding or a revelation on what they saw. Only Moses went in that cloud and he sees something. But when they worship this golden calf, they build a golden calf now. If you go back to the story where he plagued Egypt with 10 devastating plagues, he basically took them by the hand, or he led them out of the land of Egypt. They knew that cloud led them out of Egypt. They knew a golden calf didn't. You see what I'm saying? They knew that. Like when the 70 elders and the Aaronite dad and the wife came back down, they just said, look, man, if you see this cloud back there, it's a fiery cloud. It's a fiery cloud. Just like a house burning. It's so fiery that it's just burning. That cloud was on fire, man. It'd be, you know, Moses was in there, and they just say, well, you know, Moses went in that cloud, and we don't know what to do because he consumed us. We don't know. We just, you know, they just said, what should we do now, you know, since Moses gone and whatever. They just said, well, let's just build us a God, man, and say, this time brought us up out of the land of Egypt. Now, even though this is funny, Yahweh was hot, man. Now, this is the anger of Yahweh. He told Moses, he said, I'm going to destroy these people, man. They out there having fun, man. And, you know, he telling them all types of stuff. And Moses is like, well, Yahweh, you promised now that land of, you know, what you said to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And, you know, and he told them, look, and, you know, Moses was like an intercessor. That's what we have in us, too. Not Moses, but the true intercessor, which is Yahweh, Yahshua's son, you know, Yahweh's son, Yahshua. That's the intercessor in us. Now, when we start cutting up and stuff like that, Yahshua goes straight to the Father and say, well, he communicates with the Father. That way we don't get cast into the lake of fire by our ignorance and different stuff too. You get what I'm saying? So Moses was a good intercessor for some years until Joshua's son of Nun took them over to Canaan's land. But in this last day and age, it's going to be Yahshua in us that take us over to Canaan's land, which is, you know, the seventh dispensation, which is the kingdom of immortality. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm just thankful I heard the bell, and, you know, we just have to give all reverence, praise, and honor to Yahweh on him, and Yahshua the Messiah, because without Yahshua's mercy, you know, we wouldn't be here sitting in our seats in class and everything else. And, you know, discernment works, and you ask Yahshua to increase it so you can know and get a better understanding of the purpose of Yahweh. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Benjamin. For our next speaker, I'd like to call from our Ontario, California branch, Kanumi?
Kinoe.
Kleinsman.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
I enjoyed the first speaker. I'm going to go back again where he started. I've been told how important it was for Moses. And the first three times I came to class, they talked about Moses. And I said, is that all you talk about? And now I realize that everything starts from there. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go back into the garden after Moses saw the creation of the world. And on the seventh day, he saw the creation of man. And he saw the transgression. And then he understood why they had built the golden calf. Before, he wondered why, in all his innocence, that they had done that. So let's go to Genesis 3. Oh, no, let's start with the Revelations 12 and 7. And I'll, the war in heaven and the King James Version. And I'll hold on to that.
Revelation 12 and 7. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Elohim and the power of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down.
Okay, thank you. I was told, somebody asked Dr. Kinley about, I understand Moses, but I don't understand Revelation. And he said, if you understood Moses, you would understand Revelation, or you don't. And I have trouble because Moses is very clear cut. And then in Revelations, he talks about devil angels and dragons and all that. So Yahshua finally has revealed to me a little bit how this connects with what happened in the garden. So read Genesis 3 and 1.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which Yahweh Elohim had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath Elohim said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Okay, so we know that the serpent was there, but that it is not a serpent, but somebody has the, the attributes of a serpent. Now why was he here? You know that Satan is not physical, because in the war in heaven he was cast down, which meant he cannot go past the sixth step. So he cannot go into the most holy place. Mm-hmm. So this sort of helped me understand about a little bit about Revelations and about Moses. Okay, so this was a vision for Eve. And the serpent was really clever, and he didn't really tell her everything. He wanted to know what she knew. So read 3:2.
And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die.
Okay, so he knew now that she knew that if she ate it, she would die. So I'm going to skip past a lot of that. Okay, go to 6.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons.
Okay, so they are naked, which means that they were exposed, because they had done what they weren't supposed to. And there was only one law given to them, and they couldn't even keep that. But actually, I found out that these laws were only given to the Hebrews, and that we were just reading someone else's law. Okay, so go to 14.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life.
Okay, so that means that since the devil can't physically go past here, and we are considered made from the dust of the earth, therefore he is incarnate in a man, in other words, in the dust. And so, okay, continue.
And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to the husband, to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life.
Okay, so to me this kind of goes back to Revelation, where it's cursed. In the 12 and 7, read that part more around.
Revelations 12 and 9. And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Elohim and the power of the Messiah. For the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accuseth them before our Yahweh day and night. And they overcome him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they love not their lives unto death.
Okay, so to me, that kind of connects to Moses, where the blood of the Lamb, that is Yahshua, will save us. And so they're talking about that. But what Yahweh showed to me was that this kind of connects to Moses. And it shows me that since John was not supposed to say it the same way, and yet it's supposed to be connected with Moses and Revelation, mm-hmm. that this has been revealed to me, but I'm sure as I'm ready that Yahweh will reveal other things. Because I have problems with Revelation mm-hmm. and all the angels and the dragons and all that. But I know now that as I'm ready, Yahweh will reveal it to me. And maybe somebody else.
That's right. That's
one thing also. Mm-hmm. So with that I say praise Yahshua. Yeah.
No. I'm just a PR. I made that for you. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to be here among you. I told some of y'all I would visit y'all today. Nice. I really didn't believe it, but
here I am.
Yeah. Now you owe me. Come to Cali, it's okay. I appreciate the previous two speakers, okay, mm-hmm. and I always like to say this. It's always good to be here. It's good to see you here to learn more of this great, colossal, stupendous panoramic vision of Revelation bequeathed to us by Yahweh our Elohim. Mm-hmm. Through one heavenly perfect Kimmy, the founder of this organization. I was asked a question before class about something, and it's kind of like a thing that a lot of times, you're not going to find certain things in the scripture. And so you say, well, what can we do? Well, see, Yahweh has left witnesses. He did write a Bible, which is the autobiography of him before he came into the flesh. Now, I don't know of anybody that could do an autobiography before they come into the flesh. You usually do one while you're in the flesh. You know, and some people are lucky enough, like I remember one, Muhammad Ali, he did a movie, an autobiographical movie where he played himself in it. I remember an older movie, who was it? It was a guy, it's no Western, he was a Western star, Artie Murphy. Artie Murphy was a World War II hero, and they made a movie about his ex, about how he won the medals in World War II. So that was an autobiographical movie where you play yourself, see? But they were alive. They couldn't play themselves before they were born, okay? And so that's the uniqueness of this one here. Now, the scriptures is not the only witness we have. We have the universe at large, the sun, the moon, the stars. The universe itself is according to a pattern. We have this migratory track here. We call it the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe. The universe is divided up into three parts. You have a physical creation, which would be like Egypt. Then you have an incorporeal or an angelic creation, which would be like the wilderness of Sinai. And then you have eternity, which is like Canaan's land, both of which emanate from eternity. Okay, this is the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe. Now, that's a witness in itself. You also have a physical body that is a witness. We did a workshop, it might have been maybe just a little over a month ago. Somebody had witnessed it and asked us the question. They said, well, if the altar of incense here was a five-sided structure, where can you find that in the scriptures? And honestly, you can't. But yet we know it's a five-sided structure. They say, well, how can you prove that? Well, we went into the textbook and we looked in the section on the respiratory system and we found out that, lo, your lungs is five-sided. See, that's a witness, even though it's not in the Bible, but Yahweh wrote that witness on you. You see what I'm saying? Here's another example. We'll tell you this right here, that on the Day of Atonement, when the high priest went up here, he had to go in on this side of the veil. And when he went in there, he had to go up with blood and coals from off the censer. And so he had to go up here. I'm getting to the close of the minute. I left that out for a specific reason. And he had to go up here and see there were staves that were sticking out of the Ark of the Covenant, like so. So he had to get into the midst of the staves, and he had to flick the blood, turning the Ark of the Covenant around. See, because he could not turn his back on Yahweh up here. So thereby doing so, he would do this, come around, and it would be like a figure eight, so to speak, because he started here. He went in on this side, got between the staves, started flicking the blood. He could touch the staves, but he could not touch the Ark of the Covenant. So therefore, he turned it around, and came back out on the other side, like a figure eight. Now, there's nowhere in the scriptures where it says that the Ark of the Covenant is on a swivel. There's no scripture that says that. However, if I draw a line, I can look here at your Ark of the Covenant, or your head. It's on a swivel. You see what I mean? So there are ways to prove things. Because people say, well, not everything's in the scripture. That's true. But everything is written. One way or another, if it's not written in the scriptures, it's written in the universe, or it's written in your physical body. See? Now, in saying that, the question that was asked to me was this, because it does not say it here, what the high priest did on the Day of Atonement as far as his garment. I live in a Jewish neighborhood, and I've asked people, look, we got Jews of all kinds. Where I live in Los Angeles, we got Ashkenaz Jews, we got Sephardim, we got Jews from Persia. My doctor is a Persian Jew, my medical doctor, he's a Persian Jew. And they all, what I understand, see, the way they preach it, they say that the high priest wore the garments of beauty and glory daily, day in and day out, and that only on the Day of Atonement he took them off and he went in with linen garments. Now that's, for what I understand, that's the Jewish tradition, okay? Now what we have been taught here in this class is that the high priest went up here on the Day of Atonement three times. He had three sacrifices, actually four, but three blood sacrifices. One was a bullock that had to be offered. A bullock, if you don't know what a bullock is, a bullock is simply a gelded bull, a eunuch bull, that's really what it is. Because you know you can get more work out of a gelded bull than you would if one that wasn't gelded, because maybe sometimes he wouldn't feel like working, you know, and he sees the cows over there, you know. All right? It reminds me of an old joke. I won't tell it. But that was the beast of burden. That was for the high priest. Because he was as a beast of burden. I'm talking about every day, deep toiling away, daily sacrifices, practically around the clock, all this kind of stuff. So it was a job for him. The other lamb was a goat. I mean, the other animal was a goat. Actually, there were two goats. One goat was a sacrifice. Another one was a scapegoat. And see, the blood of the goat, that was for the cleansing, for the sins of the children of Israel. The scapegoat, what they would do, they would take him and they would pray the sins over the scapegoat, and they would find a fit man. Now, a fit man is just simply somebody who's kind of hard, kind of a, you know, rugged kind of guy. You might know some folks, you know, outdoorsmen, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah, so, you know, and it would tell us, look, you get the fit man, say, look, you take this goat, and you take it as far away from the camp as you can, and come back to us, okay? That was his job. The other animal was a ram. The ram was sacrificed for the cleansing of the sanctuary, because with the exception of that day, for the other days of the year, it was polluted because of sin. So therefore, the sanctuary had to be cleansed, okay? Now, each time he went up here, talking about the high priest, he would have to then take a sacrifice, and he'd have to come here to the altar of incense. One, he would have to get coals off the altar and put it in a censer. And he also had the blood of the sacrifice, and he would go up. Now, this is from what I've understood. The first two times he went up on linen garments. The third time he went up, he had to put on the garments of beauty and glory. All right? Now, the question is, how can you prove that? That's the question. Anybody got a textbook? Mm-hmm. I just need you, because see, I need the illustration. I forgot my 40 plate, Charlie left it in. I need the charts. The 40 plate, that's probably in the first slide. Here's what I got going here. Now, the first speaker and the second speaker, they told you to concentrate on it. Moses is the principal thing. If you understand Moses, you will understand everything, honestly. Because Moses sets up everything. Well, we may as well get it. Isaiah 8:20.
To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
Okay, now to the law and to the testimony. Now what is the law? The law is the first five books of the Bible. That's what Moses wrote. And listen, these theologians out there, they know Moses wrote the first five books. They know Moses wrote the book of Genesis. I mean, you can go get your, like, one of those Gideon Bibles, and just open it up to the first page of Genesis, and it will say it in the head. Genesis, the first book of Moses. So they know that. The problem is, they don't know how did Moses come about this information.
Right.
That's what they don't understand. And we show you that it came about by a divine vision and revelation. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, to receive this vision, Moses had to go up this mountain three times. He made three distinct trips up into this mountain, okay? And that's the key to really, to help understand the three trips that the high priest made into the most holy place, okay? So what I want to do, I could easily just say the answer, but unless I kind of draw it out a little bit, or as I think the founder put it like this, whenever you have a subject, you have to have a predicate prior to the subject that leads to the subject. So I have to give you a little bit of predicate first so that you can understand why I'm doing this. so that when we get to the subject, it'll, you'll see it, it'll just, you say, ah, okay, now I get it. See, that's what we want to do. Mm-hmm. Now, Moses made three trips up into his mount. And the reason why I wanted the 40 plate chart is this. Because we know Yahshua Messiah, what is his mission? What is his mission? To fulfill the scriptures. Mm-hmm. He's fulfilling, which means he's got to, he's going to bring it to an end. That's what fulfill means. But to bring it to an end, he has to perform it. Because when he performs it, that's the conclusion. Mm-hmm. He's bringing it to an end. Now, we told you Moses had, he made three trips up this mountain. So Yahshua the Messiah, who is the fulfillment of what Moses and the prophets wrote, he has to fulfill that. One of the best ways I can look at to show that is on the plates. Here we have plates. I don't know if you can't see it, but plates 20, let's see, here we got it. Yeah, plates 29, plate 30, and plate 31. Plate 29 deals with the Sermon on the Mount, his ministry, because it starts off here. He comes into the world, blood, you know, blood running warm in his veins, a prepared sacrifice. And then he goes to John the Baptist to be baptized. And he's out in the wilderness, being tested by the adversary. And then here's the Sermon on the Mount. That's the culmination or the fulfillment of Moses' first trip into the mount. Okay? Let's try to walk through it and I'll show you what I mean. Let's get Matthew 3:13. Now, I already said here, see, let me say this. You want to understand these charts, I'm going to tell you a secret. It's really not a secret, but to some people, it is. This is a pattern of the tabernacle. We just told you, this is the migratory pattern. You know, or in other words, this is the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe. The correlation, there are seven steps in this pattern, just like there are seven steps in this migratory trek. The correlation between this pattern and this pattern, if you know the correlation between these two plates, then you know all the plates. It's really that simple. What do I mean? Because the same correlations you're going to use in comparing these two plates, you're going to use on all of them. Because they're the same thing in principle. Why? The principle remains the same. The manifestation may change, but the principle remains the same. Here and here, you're going to learn about the principles. I'll give you an example. There's seven steps here. The first step is the gate. As Yahshua said, you know, almost into, you know, gate is, wide is the gate that leads to destruction. Why? Because the first thing you're going to run into is this brazen altar of sin sacrifice, full of fire, right? All right. Now, the gate here is correlated to the door of the Israelites' homes during the Passover when they had to put the blood sign. That's what that's correlated to. The second step is this altar of sin sacrifice with blood on the four horns. See, and the sacrifice. Type of, you know, principle of blood. Over here, they had to put four points of blood on the door, the lintel, the two side posts, and the basin. All right, that's the corollary. Here, the third step is this brazen laver. Since that brazen laver, where they did the washing, is also a type of the washing of regeneration. Okay, draw a line. That's likened to the Red Sea. Okay, because the Israelites were baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. The door is the fourth step. At the door you have the cup of holy anointing oil. That is correlated to the cloud that led them out of Egypt. There was also an angel in that cloud, okay? Now, here you have the holy place. That is the fifth step. The whole holy place is the fifth step, okay? Now, the 40 principle is that it took 40 weeks for them to construct this tabernacle. Over here, they ended up being out in the wilderness 40 years, okay? Mm-hmm. Now you can describe these articles, and you can get real persnickety with it, you know, talk about the table of shewbread with 12 loaves and a golden crown around it, and you need to know these things. I'm not taking nothing from that. But the thing I'm trying to impress upon you is simply this. Understand the principles of what they represent. I could just make this real succinct and say this: light, bread, intercessor. Mm-hmm. Now, that's about as succinct as I can get that. Mm-hmm. But those are principles. See, the same principles that you see, they're going to appear in every holy place on these charts. You understand? This is your prototype. No, I take that back. This is your archetype, okay? By which you're going to use to measure everything with. So I'm trying to show that the correlations you use for this and this are the same correlations you're going to use here, 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 here. You. It's all correlated because it's all by the pattern. Here, they had light out here. It was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Yahweh rained manna from heaven, bread. They had an intercessor, the Holy Spirit and Moses. He was intercessor, but you didn't even go personally. I told you they had an angel in that cloud. See? Because when Moses went up here, into the mount, see, who did he meet up here? He met Joshua. Because it was, see, on the second trip, Joshua transfigured or transformed in front of him. Now, on the third trip, Joshua did not go up with him. Right. He was here. Where's that? Right here. He was here in the meeting tent of the congregation. And Moses went up by himself. But Joshua, who was in the meeting tent of the congregation, astral projected himself up into the mount so that Moses could see him. Okay? Now, the sixth step in this pattern is the second departmental veil of the scar. See, that was written in twain when Yahshua was on the cross. He died on the cross. The veil in the temple was written in twain. You draw a line. When the Israelites wanted to cross over to the Red Sea, that went in twain to the Jordan River. That is representative of the veil, or the sixth step. Mm-hmm. That had to be, just like here, the waters divided, separated, same way here, okay? The seventh step is this whole Ark of the Covenant, where you had a mercy seat, two angels on top of it. Inside the Ark of the Covenant, you have the second tables of stone that Moses brought up, because the first table he broke. Mm-hmm. It was brought out by the golden calf. See, Moses broke them. And that's symbolic, and he had to do that. Mm-hmm. Because it's symbolic. The two tables of stone is symbolic of the two covenants. Mm-hmm. The first covenant he broke. Mm-hmm. So then he was told, hew thee out your own tables of stone, which was in the shape of a heart, and look. The first tables of stone was cut out of the indentation in the mount that Elohim wrote on. So the second tables of stone Moses had to bring up had to fit in the same spot where the first one came out of. And Elohim would write on it. Well, in other words, he's writing on his own heart. That's what that is symbolized over here, the New Testament. Written in the heart and mind. See? Okay? Also in here, you had a pot of manna and Aaron's rod that budded at the almonds. This symbolized the throne of Yahweh, or the authority, okay? Draw a line. In time, Solomon built the temple up here. This temple was also threefold. It was a porch, a sanctuary, and an oracle. And it was built on Mount Moriah in different levels. In other words, if I remember right, in the court round about, there were two giant brass chapters, right? That looked, when you look at it from a distance, they look like legs. In fact, they even had names. One chapter was called Jachin, and the other one was called Boaz. And when you put it together, it simply means in his strength. Okay? And so that's kind of like legs. And then you go to the next level, to the sanctuary, and it's another level. And then you go to the oracle, which had a golden dome. It really looked like a man sitting on a throne, okay? And the golden dome would reflect light. You would see it, you know, blinding. Why would it do that? Well, because on the Day of Atonement, when the high priest did his 21st flick and everything he did was proper, then he would see a flash of light in his consciousness. That is, he would see a vision of Elohim in his cloud. And that would tell him, oh, the sins of the Israelites were forgiven. And see, and the Israelites would know this because, see, when he went in here, the day that he went in here, I think the scripture says, You know, Yahweh is in this holy temple, and all the earth, you know, keeps silent before him. These people had to be quiet while this high priest was doing it, because see, the high priest, this illustration, here, the high priest, see, on his garment, he had bells and pomegranates, and they could hear the bells. So everybody had to be quiet, muzzle your animals, don't move, don't move, be quiet, because Yahweh is in his holy sanctuary. Let all the earth be silent. So they had to hear these bells while this high priest is doing it. And if the bells stopped at any time before the 21st brick of blood, they know something happened. He done screwed up. All right? But they're not going to go in that holy place to go get him. You know what they're going to do? They're going to get these brass paws, these meat hooks. They're going to stand at the veil, and they're going to go up under there and try to feel him out. All right. Okay, we got him last. All right. He-ho. Him out, because he done messed up, and that, and shoot, if Yahweh broke forth on him, what person, what sane person is going to go in there after that? I'm not that. See, so now, that's the pattern. That's the steps of the pattern compared to the migratory trip. You know, now you can get real persnickety with the correlation, but those are the seven basic correlations you need to know. You know those correlations, you will know me Christ. Okay? Now, this, I did say Matthew, right? Matthew 3:13. That's what we want to do. We're going to walk through this. See, we want to walk through this and show you how spirit law is operating. Okay? According to a pattern. All right? Matthew
3:13.
Mm-hmm.
Then cometh Joshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be immersed of him.
Mm-hmm.
But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be immersed of thee, and comest thou to me?
Mm-hmm.
And Joshua answering said unto him, Permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
Then he permitted him.
Okay, go ahead.
Joshua, when he was immersed, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him.
Now see, let's just listen carefully. Here he is, we got this here. He's a prepared sacrificial body. Now if you know, when you correlate it to migratory trek, they took the lamb out on the 10th and held it over to the 14th, and they slew it between the two evenings. Mm-hmm. See, 3.5. So here he is held over, because he's starting his ministry. So he's going to be held over for 3.5, prepared sacrifice, held over for 3.5 years. That's a death, prepared for death. Here he is, he's being buried, or baptized by John the Baptist. Keep reading.
And he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descending like a dove,
mm-hmm.
and lighting upon him.
That's the Spirit. You can correlate that with the cloud of the Israelites going through the Red Sea. It's all correlated. Continue.
And lo, a voice from heaven saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
And it said in there, I think you read it, said the heavens were open, right? Why? Because the Red Sea opened up back there. That's the correlation. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Continue.
Chapter 4.
Yes.
Then was Joshua led up, the Spirit, into the wilderness to be tempted of the adversary.
Uh-huh.
And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry.
Now, he said 40 days, 40 nights. Why 40 days, 40 nights? He's in the wilderness of Judea. He is fulfilling the Israelites being in the wilderness of Sinai for 40 years. Okay? Continue.
And then the tempter came to him and said, If thou be the Son of Yahweh, command that these stones be made bread.
Mm-hmm.
But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of Yahweh.
Now, why is he talking about bread? Well, we got according to the pattern. We're in the holy place. So there's got to be a mention of bread. See? Now that works. See? And let me see something else as we hear. Satan said, well, you know, why don't you turn these rocks into bread? Look, they weren't no ordinary rocks. Okay? Let's get that straight. Not just a bunch of stuff. You know, these were certain type of rocks. These were special stones. In other words, you go back and read. It's in the book of Joshua. When Joshua, son of Nun, when the Jordan River, as we told you, it divided. And they went across on dry land. But what Joshua had to do, they took rocks out of the middle of the Jordan, the divided part of the Jordan, and they set it up on the other side as a landmark, okay? And so where the satanic spirit is, Satan is, and Yahshua, they're near this landmark. And so he sees this landmark, these stones that Joshua, that Yahshua himself put there, 50, you know, hundreds of years before, and you know, his Satan, because he's the sly one. Oh, well, you know, what about these stones here? You hungry? Why don't you just change them to bread? Not just one thing, but this was a landmark right here that he was telling them to change. And Yahshua said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of Yahweh. See? See, a lot of these things, see, if you go back and how can I put it? How can I say it? Check with the law and the prophets. Look, everything Yahshua is doing is a fulfillment of something. I don't care. If he bat his eye, it's a fulfillment of something. Look, this is a man who in 33 and a half years fulfilled 4,000 years of people, places, and things. Now tell me somebody else that could do a work like that. I'm in my 60s, I ain't nowhere near doing what I, you know what I'm saying? It's just that, you know, I don't think you're gonna find anybody in human history that labored like that. 4,000 years, people, places and things in 33 and a half years. That's why that one scripture, John says, I suppose if all the books could be written about what Yahshua did, the world couldn't contain it.
Yeah.
All right.
See? Continue reading.
Then the adversary taketh him up into the holy city, mm-hmm. set him on a pinnacle.
Why a pinnacle? See, he said, and we got the illustration here. See, we got this because he's showing him the kingdoms of the world. If you don't know what they are, I suggest you get your Daniel chart. And that's so smooth. He said, you know, he's saying, well, look, he's showing him all the kingdoms of the world, read.
And saith unto him, mm-hmm. If thou be the son of Yahweh, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee.
That we haven't got to that yet, but yeah. And listen, that's scripture. Satan is quoting scripture to him. See, he knows the Bible better than most of us. Yeah. See? And so he spoke scripture to the one who wrote the scripture. They said, well, didn't you write? Didn't you say that, you know, the angel, didn't you say that? You wrote that, didn't you? Okay. See? And see, that pinnacle, he put the pinnacle, see that pinnacle, what's a pinnacle? Here's the pinnacle. Right here. Put him on a pinnacle. See, he stands there, well. If, you know, you can fall, the scripture says the angels will catch you, so you won't even dash your foot, you know, what you scared of. But read.
If thou be the son of Yahweh, cast thyself down, for mm-hmm. it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, to mm-hmm. guard thee in all thy ways, mm-hmm. and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against the stone.
Mm-hmm.
Yahshua said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt Yahweh thy Elohim.
Read.
Again, the adversary taketh him into an exceeding high mountain,
mm-hmm.
and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world.
That's the point, yeah, showing all the kingdoms of the world. You know, that's the Daniel chart. Read.
And the glory of them.
And the glory of them all. You know, all the magnificence, you know, Babylon, Medes and Persia, the Greeks, the Romans, you know, whoever, you know. Look how glorious all the. I'll give this to you. If we
and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee,
mm-hmm.
if thou wilt fall down and worship me.
That's pretty smooth. It was the one who he's talking to, that was the one who gave the kingdoms to him. And then you're going to turn around, yeah, right, you worship me, I'll give you all this. I mean, he's just too smooth a con artist, right? But we
then saith Yahshua unto him,
uh-huh.
Get thee hence, Satan. For it is written, thou shalt worship Yahweh thy Elohim, mm-hmm. and him only shalt thou serve.
Continue.
Then the adversary leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him.
They came and ministered. Why? Because, see, there was an angel in that cloud back here, right? That was Joshua, son of Nun. Wasn't he Moses' minister? You see, everything Joshua was doing is a fulfillment. Something back here that Moses and the prophets wrote. Continue.
Now when Yahshua had heard that John was cast into prison, uh-huh. he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum,
mm-hmm.
which is upon the sea coast, in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali,
mm-hmm.
in fulfillment of that which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet.
Listen carefully, read.
Saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the nations,
mm-hmm.
the people which walk in darkness have seen great light.
Oh, look on this plate. We're still in the holy place. Why are we talking about light? Mm-hmm. See my point? Mm-hmm. Light, bread, intercessor. Mm-hmm. Yahshua's fulfilling these plates. It's all according to a pattern. Continue.
And to them which dwelt in the regions of the shadow of death, light hath shined upon them.
Okay, light has shined upon them. Okay, jump down to 23.
And Yahshua went about all Galilee,
mm-hmm.
teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the glad tidings of the kingdom,
mm-hmm.
and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of diseases among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria,
uh-huh.
and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with various diseases,
mm-hmm.
and torments, and those which were possessed with demons, and those which were lunatics, and those that were paralytic, and he healed them.
Mm-hmm.
And there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee,
mm-hmm.
and from
Decapolis, mm-hmm.
and from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan.
And from beyond the Jordan. When it says from beyond the Jordan, that means on the other side of the Jordan. So you had great multitudes following Yahshua from beyond the Jordan, from the other side of the Jordan, on up into Israel. Why? Didn't a great multitude follow Joshua, the son of Nun, mm-hmm. into Canaan's land? He's fulfilling. John Tittle, he's fulfilling. He's going the same, but you just read that it's the same track the Israelites just went through. He's fulfilling it. Keep reading.
Chapter 5.
Yes.
And seeing the multitudes,
uh-huh.
he went up into a mountain.
Mm-hmm.
And when he was set, his disciples came unto
him. He was set. In other words, he's set on a mountain. Why? Then this cloud, when it first came up out of Egypt, and they led these Israelites here, it went and set on a mountain. What we're reading here, this is the fulfillment of Moses' first trip in the mount. What happened on Moses' first trip? The cloud sat up there. Moses was told to come up and to give instructions. But also, this cloud thundered down the Ten Commandment law in the hearing of the Israelites. Correct? Read.
And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying,
mm-hmm.
Blessed are the poor in spirit,
uh-huh.
for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Now these are the so-called Beatitudes, see. Mm-hmm. And even in that, Yahshua, he's speaking, but he's fulfilling. That's his mission, correct? Now he said, blessed are the poor in spirit, because, say that again.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
The Israelites, they were poor in spirit. They didn't have a Holy Spirit. And type theirs was the kingdom of heaven, or Canaan's land, the promised land. See that? Everything Yahshua is saying, doing, is a fulfillment of what Moses and the prophets wrote. Continue.
Blessed are they that mourn because of sin,
uh-huh.
for they shall be comforted.
See, that's what happened down here. They were mourning, they were in bondage. But Yahweh came to them and comforted them. He brought them deliverance. Continue.
Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
Now Moses, he was told he was the meekest man that ever walked the earth. How did he inherit the earth? He was shown the creation of the heavens and the earth. See? Continue.
Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled.
See, now back here, weren't they hungry back here in a type? Yahweh rained manna from heaven, mm-hmm. gave them quails, water from the rock, constant daylight, their clothes and shoes didn't wear out. See? Continue.
Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain. Mercy.
So I say, blessed are the merciful. To Moses, remember when they screwed up, you know, when they didn't sin. Moses said, look, these people have really messed up. If you would, blot my name out of the book.
Right.
But Yahweh said, I will be merciful for whom I will be merciful to. Mm-hmm. See, continue.
Blessed are the pure in heart,
uh-huh.
for they shall see Yahweh.
Now say, now blessed are the pure. Now Moses was pure in heart, not Moses himself. But the Holy Spirit in Moses, because see, when he was born, what was said about him? Oh, this is a goodly child. Oh, hell, any child's a goodly child to a parent. But he was trying to show that he had the Holy Spirit in him. And he did. he did see Yahweh. See? Okay? Read.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of Yahweh.
Okay, now blessed are the peacemakers. Now the peacemaker out here, that was Joshua, son of Nun. See, it's no different than today. See, they was having problems out here. Like, for example, they came to Joshua and said, hey, Joshua, Amalek and his boys is causing a ruckus outside the camp, and they're disturbing the peace. If you would, why don't you just go out there, and deal with it if you please. So Joshua got some men, strapped on their swords, and they went out there and they dealt with it. And when that last Amalekite fell, peace had been restored. Right? That's no different today. I mean, if you're trying to sleep, in the middle of the night and something, your neighbors is giving a party, you call the popos, the police. And they come over and they bang on the door. Hey, you're gonna have to cut that noise down, we're gonna run you in. You're disturbing the peace. Or like where I live at, I live in West LA, and I live near the federal building, and a lot of times they do a lot of protests there. Like they'll protest the war and stuff, they'll get out there, they got these signs, stop the war or whatever, they're protesting something, and you say, stop the war, stop, and you think those are the peacemakers. And I'm like, no, they're not. They're disturbing the peace because they're out here, they're blocking traffic, they're blocking the sidewalk. Get the popos over here and tell them go somewhere out of the way because they're disturbing my peace. See, that's how it works. Okay, continue.
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Now they were persecuted. Now, if you remember the story of Balaam, he was a hireling prophet. He was the guy, if you don't know who Balaam was, he was the guy where his animal spoke to him. Because and the animal loved her master because she saw the angel and he didn't. And he tried to turn aside because the angel, and let me say something about that angel. Because a lot of people think, oh, that was Michael the archangel. No, that was not. That was Joshua, son of Nun, astral projecting out here. To where Balaam was at, to where that, because he's standing out there with, because remember, he's the angel in the cloud. And what does it say? Exodus 23 and 20 says, look, do not provoke this angel, because he will not pardon your transgression. Well, Balaam provoked that angel, and that angel's standing there with a sword. You're going to provoke me, and I ain't going to pardon you. But see, but the donkey, the beast, he'll turn aside three times, as a matter of fact, so that her master wouldn't get killed. And then the angel says, and even the angel told Balaam, said, well, what if for your beast, I'd have killed you by now. But that wasn't Michael. That was Joshua's son of the, I'll prove it. I'll just stay right there. You stay there. Something you get the other scripture. And just right quick, because we're coming back. It's Joshua 24th chapter. I'll show you. Joshua 24:9.
Then Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab, rose and warred against Israel, and sent and called Balaam, the son of Beor, to curse you. But I would not hearken unto Balaam, therefore he blessed you still. So I delivered you out of his hand.
I delivered you out of his hand. I did that, okay? Because Joshua's telling these Israelites, he started at the beginning of the chapter and said, look, I did this. I did that. And he's saying, I was the one that delivered you from Balaam. In other words, I was that angel with the sword standing there ready to kill this sucker. You get it now? The Law of the Prophets has a lot of answers if you look for them. Now we can go back to Matthew.
Verse 11. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evils against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you.
Okay, jump down to 21. Now this is where the pudding is. Because see, we told you that Yahshua, he's sitting on a mount. This is the sermon on the mount. And he's talking to a multitude. And it's a fulfillment of Moses' first trip in the mount, where the cloud is on the mount and Elohim is speaking to Israel. So the same thing that Yahshua's got to say is got to be similar to what Elohim said. 21. Verse 21.
Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit murder, and whosoever committeth murder shall be in danger of the court of justice.
Now, why did he say that? Is that what Yahweh said back here when he thundered down the Ten Commandment law? You understand? Mm-hmm. Yahshua's doing the same thing. He's fulfilling. Jump down to 27.
Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery.
Uh-huh. Why did he say that? Didn't Yahweh say that back here? See what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. 33rd verse.
Mm-hmm. Again, ye have heard that it hath been said by them of old time, thou shalt not swear to a lie, but shall make as unto Yahweh thine oaths.
Okay, that's what Yahweh spoke down to them as well. See, Yahshua is fulfilling Moses' first trip into the mount. You see that now? Okay, now, let's go to the second trip Moses made. We all know this by now. If you don't, you should. Exodus 24, 9 and 10 will state that Moses narrated in the bayou and 70 elders of Israel. They stood out here and they saw the Elohim of Israel. And they went on to describe him. He had a feet, you know, describe his feet, his body, standing on the pavement of a sapphire stone. Moses is going up with his minister Joshua into this cloud. Joshua transfigures for Moses into this and shows Moses this panoramic vision. He's up there 40 days. The first 7 days, he sees the vision. The other 33 days, he sees the inner workings of this tabernacle. Okay? Now, let's go to the chart. This is plate 30. It's called Miracles and It's called Baptism and Miracles. No, that's right. Yeah, Miracles and Transfiguration. I'm sorry. Plate 30. Now, we got the same thing here. Prepared sacrifice. Joshua's that prepared sacrifice. What I need. I think it's Matthew 8:22.
Matthew 8:22. 23. Yes. And when he entered into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep.
It was covered with the waves. In other words, they were in the water, and it was covered with the waves. They thought they were dying or dead. And covered with the waves, they're in a burial. Get it? And it's right here. That's the position it's at. The same position as the brazen laver or the Red Sea. Okay, continue.
And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Rabbi, save us, you perish.
Uh-huh.
And he saith unto them, why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm.
Now that was the spirit of Elohim. Look, let me tell you something here. When we talk about universal spirit law and the Holy Spirit, when you really understand that they're really both one and the same, it's Elohim. And see, Yahshua the Messiah, when the winds and the waves obeyed him, why did they obey him? Because they recognized who he was. He was there at their inception. So they were like, oh, okay, you know who you are. That was the spirit. That's the principle. The spirit. That's why. That's like a cup of holy anointing oil at the door. That's like the cloud here going through the Red Sea. It's a type of spirit. You understand? You're looking at principles. Once you understand the principles, you'll cut through the manifestations. Truly. And it won't take that much practice because Yahweh will show you as you'll see and say, oh, okay. Well, I see what's happening here, and it's got to happen the same over here. That kind of thing. Keep reading.
And the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this?
Read.
Where?
Keep going.
That even the winds and the sea obey him.
Mm-hmm.
And when he was come to the other side, into the country of...
The Gadarenes. That's what it says. You know the holy name?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, okay, I might say something else. I have Gadarenes, but that's all right. Don't keep going.
There met him two possessed with demons coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way.
Okay, why two men? Let's go back to the migratory trek. Remember when the Israelites had to go through the divided waters of the Red Sea? They had to pass through two mountains. Right? They had to pass through two mountains. So here's Joshua, these two men. He's got to pass through them. But this is what's going to happen. Read.
And behold, they cried out, saying, what have we to do with thee, Joshua, thou son of Yahweh? Art thou come hither to torment us before the set time?
Mm-hmm.
And there was a good way off, from them a herd of many swine feeding.
Mm-hmm.
So the demons besought him, saying, if thou cast us out, permit us to go away into the herd of swine.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto them, go. And when they were come out, they went into the herd of swine. And behold, the whole herd of swine ran violently down a steep place into the sea and perished.
Now, why did they do that? Go back to the migratory track. Didn't Pharaoh and his host, and they run violently into the Red Sea and drown? See, everything he's doing is a fulfillment. It's a repetition. See? It's the same thing. Okay? Now, what we have here? Okay, now, we go here, and it talks about his miracles and ministry. Now, you can really pick up a few things from there. It also has an illustration of Lazarus being raised from the dead. Now, in the miracles and ministry, let's just do, we'll pick one out. I can just, and you pretty much know this one. Remember when he fed the multitude? How did he feed them? You know, five loaves of bread and two little fishes. Bread. That's in the holy place. Says his miracles and ministry. That's in the holy place. See? Okay? Get Lazarus back. It's in John. I want to deal, when he's dealing with, Yahshua dealing with Lazarus and his sisters. And, I think it's the 11th chapter of John. Okay, how much time? I got to expedite. Okay, just expedite. Lazarus is sick. Yahshua's going to go visit. Okay, but by the time Yahshua got there, Lazarus died. And so everybody was like boo-hooing and just crying and, you know, that kind of thing. And see, this brings about one of the most famous scriptures, you know. Let's see. Jump down to John 11 and 32. We start there. John 11 and 32.
32.
Yes.
Then when Miriam was came where Yahshua was,
mm-hmm.
and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Rabboni, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died.
Mm-hmm.
When Yahshua therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, where have ye laid him? They say unto him, Rabbi, come and see. Yahshua wept.
Oh, the most famous scripture in the world. Yahshua wept. I used to have an aunt. We used to, when we invited over dinner, we had, you know, that's during the days when we used to all say grace. And everybody say they go long with grace. And then my aunt, my aunt Bertha, she's so funny. And they come to her turn, she just come up, put her hand on her, and she said, Jesus wept. And I'd be like, what kind of prayer is that? He wept. I said, okay, well, what are you asking for? You asking for him to cry for you or something? I'm like, I never could get that. But people say, oh, read the next scripture after that. What does it say?
Then said the Jews, behold, how he loved him.
Oh, and they think, oh, he must have really loved him. He's looking, he's weeping. He's not weeping because of that. He's weeping because you don't believe who I am. I am the resurrection and the life. He's the resurrection. So, I mean, and then you're going to sit and tell me, you know, that, you should have been here. I'm the resurrection. I'm here. Oh, and like, and he's just crying because, oh my God, what am I going to do with these people? What am I going to do with these people, man? And this is carnal minds he's dealing with. And he's crying because they don't understand who he is. See, he is that light. See, that's in the holy place. He's the light. And they keep reading.
And some of them said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, cause that even this man should not have died? Joshua therefore again, groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. There was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Joshua said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said to him, Rabbi, why are they lifting away the stone? But this time he stinketh. For he
had
been dead 4 days.
He'd been dead 4 days. Why 4 days? Well, see, Joshua, mankind, when you stop and think about it, had been dead for 4,000 years. Here's Joshua coming in the 4,000 years to alleviate that death from man that had been put upon him by the man Adam. Because in Adam, all died.
Nice.
Okay? Continue.
Joshua saith unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of Yahweh? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Joshua lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me.
He's doing intercession. Altar of incense. Because when they did prayer in the tabernacle, where did they do that? Here. See my point? Continue.
And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth.
Now he said, Lazarus, come forth. And he had to say it that way. He had to call Lazarus by name. Had he just simply said, come forth, everybody on the planet would have got put a king forth. He's the resurrection and the life. What do you think? You think that was just going to, his power was just going to go last as the sound, like, okay, come forth. And people out the room, oh, they didn't hear him. Oh, no. The whole world would have heard that. The whole world would have got up and came forth and yes, sir. But he had to be specific. Lazarus, come forth. Called him by name. Why? Back here. Remember back here with Moses. And they sinned back here. And Moses, you know, treated Yahweh. Said, you know, they've sinned the sinners in your sin. You know, blot my name out of your book of life. And said, whoever sinned against me, his name will I blot out of the book of life. The fact that he called Lazarus out lets you know that Lazarus was written in that book of life. Get it? See? 17th chapter of John, because this culminates with the Mount of Transfiguration. Quickly. And then I can tie all this together.
John 17.
Yes, here's one, please, yes.
These words spake Joshua and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said.
Oh, wait a minute. Is that the right scripture? No, that's not. Where's that? Oh, I'm sorry. Matthew 17. Forgive me.
And after 6 days, Joshua taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain. And was transfigured before them. And his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as light.
Now we have that up here. We profile this here. Okay? This is a fulfillment of Moses' second trip into the mountain. What to continue.
And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with him.
The law and the prophets, witnessing him. Okay, continue.
Then answered Peter and said unto Joshua,
Sire,
it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make 3 tabernacles.
Why is he saying that? Because back here, a tabernacle was mentioned back here. See, you can even get more perspicuous. Here you got Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu. Aaron was the elder. Nadab and Abihu were brothers. Peter was the elder of the disciples. James and John were brothers. 70 elders were up here that witnessed this. Not long after this event, 70 were chosen to go out 2 by 2. See, that's a fulfillment of this. Okay? Continue.
While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear ye him.
Mm-hmm.
And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces, and were greatly frightened. And Joshua came and touched them, and said, Arise, and be not afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man, save Joshua only.
Mm-hmm.
And as they came down from the mountain, Joshua charged them, saying, Tell the vision to no man, until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead.
Let you know that he had been back here before, lived before, died before, resurrected. Joshua, son of God. Okay? Now, that's the first two trips to the mountain. Now, I can go over to the third trip because you have it illustrated here. Joshua's death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. This is the fulfillment of Moses' third trip into the mountain. Moses, when he's called back up, he has to bring it back up and set the tables of stone. He gets a rerun of the vision, 7 days. Then he sees the transgression and the subsequent 63 generations of the flesh coming out afterwards. Even to the point where he even sees his own self being born. He sees his mother and father, Courtney and Sparkin. I don't know, that's an old term. But he sees that. He sees his own self being born. He even sees his own self going through all of this stuff and dying at Mount Nebo. And he was shown all the way down to Joshua's death, burial, resurrection, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. But he was only told to write all the way up to his death. But he saw it all. But that's okay, because John's confirming it, because see, with John over here, he was told something similar. He saw the heavens and the earth too, but he was told not to write it, because somebody, we got that covered. Okay? That's how Yahweh do this. Yeah, he'll show you everything, but he'll just say, okay, I just want you to do that part. Because I got somebody else doing that part. See, it's like pieces of a puzzle. You have to get these different parts and put them together so that you can see the grander picture of what Yahweh is doing. Now, he's going through death, burial, resurrection. And look, it's the same thing here, like bread intercessor. Because I can just show you right quick. Luke 23:44. I know I'm running out of time, but I'm almost there. Luke 24, I want the 2 men on the road to Emmaus. That's what I want. Yeah, 24:25, quickly.
Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken, ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
Mm-hmm.
And they drew near unto the village where they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, he took bread.
When did this happen? Wasn't this during the 40-day period? This is the holy place, ain't it? Gotta have a mention of bread. See what I'm saying? He's fulfilling John the Tiller. And the light over here, I'm out of time, but the light over here is the sunrise, the first light, because he rose the same as the sunrise. So that's the light. And he's the intercessor, see, because he broke bread and he prayed. See, all of that is being manifested here. And then he goes to the Mount of Olives. Okay, let's get that, because I'm out of time. Acts 1 and 2, I think. Start with 6, 1 and 6.
Acts 1 and 6.
Uh-huh.
When they, therefore, were come together, they asked of him, saying, Master, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?
Uh-huh.
And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons, which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
Okay, now a cloud received him out of their sight. Why? This is like unto the third trip of Moses' trip into the mount. It is also like the third trip of the high priest into the most holy place. Now I can explain why I think the high priest, on the Day of Atonement, the first two times he went in with linen garments. Why do I say that? Because the linen garments represents the flesh. Yahshua is in a physical body. Here, he's in a physical body. It's death, burial, resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15, somewhere around there, by when Yahshua was resurrected with a quickening spirit, somewhere around there. And see, he went in a physical body, but he came out a quickening spirit, a glorified body, which is likened unto the garments of beauty and glory. Get it? So that's why, see, even though there's no scripture on it, but I can see Yahshua in his fulfillment of that. I can see him, the three trips that he's going up the mount fulfilling Moses is likened to the three trips going into the most holy place on the Day of Atonement. The first two trips he went up the mountain, he was in a physical body. That would be like the linen garments. But the third trip he went up on, this is a mount too, this is Mount Olivet. So the third trip he went up, see, he changed clothes. Mm-hmm. He went from physical to spiritual, putting on garments of beauty and glory. And here he is here. That's my proof that I offer to show that the high priest went up here. First two times, linen garments. Third time, the garments of beauty and glory. Okay? Mm-hmm. I hope that... If you have any questions, you're more than welcome to ask. But that's what I've understood, and that's the best way that I see that you can prove that. You have to use Yahshua, the scriptures, and the things he's... Because see, Yahshua's fulfilling John 2. It's like this. Now, I'll be done. It's like a mathematical equation. If you know 1 plus 2 equals 3, all right? Two add-ins that equal... to a sum. But if I didn't know that, how would I determine the missing quotient? How would I determine that? Well, I take that which is known, right? The sum and one of the addends. See? And that will tell me what that is. The Bible is no different. Law plus prophecy equals fulfillment.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm missing something, then how do I find out? I take that which is known. It's really that simple. Okay? And that's what's so great about this doctrine. You know, people expect something, you know, like, oh, this is just some, you know, you have to be a genius to understand this and endowed with certain faculties and so forth. No. If the Father said, even a fool can understand this. And if you can't understand this, well, gee whiz, how much worse of a fool can you be? But that can't be. Because Yahweh would will that no one should be lost. And see, that's the thing we want. And then we take this message to the world, we show this to the world so that you too can appreciate and share and indulge in the great glory of this gospel. Not just today as we suffer through these physical bodies, but from eternity to eternity. Okay? Hey, thank you very much for your time and your patience. I appreciate you. You know you got an open invitation to come and visit us. All right? Thank you very much. And with those few words, praise Yahshua.
Appreciate it. Let's conclude that class. Can we all stand for that time? now unto him that will keep you from falling, and present you faultless before his glory with exceeding joy. To the all-wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua Messiah, our Sovereign, the long-run glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both before all time, now and ever, let us all say,
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good class. Hi, Carly.
How are you doing?
Good, how are you?
I'm good, how are you doing?
Yes, sir. Is there any witnesses in his third trip up the mountain?
As far as
Edgerton Blue?
No, it's just basically just him. He himself is transformed.
I know when he comes down, he has to.
Oh, you're talking about Moses.
Oh, Moses.
Oh, you know, Moses' face glowed. He's like, yeah, that's a type. That's a type of that. That's a type of that.
And it glowed because he seen his glory.
He saw both. Both mysteries. Because the first time he went up, he went up to Adam and Eve. He didn't see the transgression, so he saw the power. And then when he went back up, that's when he saw the transgression. He saw the negative. It's just like this light. It takes a positive and a negative to give you illumination. So when he came back down the second time and saw Israel transgressed, he didn't understand that because he had just left them up in the garden full of, in peace and harmony. So he broke the tables of stone. But then when he went back up and saw the transgression, then he understood because Israel was a type of East. So he understood and so he was illuminated. Yeah. Yeah.
Which is, what the Shekinah does.
Right. It's the same thing in principle. Right. It's the same thing.
And he's seen Yahweh in a different way that third time, right? Because remember when he passed by?
Oh, yeah. He saw his back part. Right. But he wasn't allowed to see his front. But it's in eternity. As he's walking away from Moses, you read in the first chapter of Revelation, he's coming towards John, and he's full front of him. Why? Because the veils have been ripped. So now you can see.
I remember
see the full glory.
And then I forgot.
Another one. Have you ever heard when the high priest came out after the spirit and walked out of the gate?
He's pretty much free.
That's when the trumpets blew.
I believe so.
There's two trumpets. One on the side.
I believe that's right. Yeah. Because that would let the Israelites know that everything was complete.
That was your trip. Representing Yahshua sending his Holy Spirit. Because his third trip, then sending the Holy Spirit down.
Oh, okay.
The high priest coming down.
Yeah.
Giving them the Holy Spirit.
The good news. The good news.
Blowing their trumpet.
No, but it's, it's a type. You can say it's a type. They didn't see those, but the blowing of the trumpets is like pictures of the house and all of that. So,
I don't think that's when they knew. The priest did it right.
Yeah,
it's when he walked out.
Yeah, and they saw him and said, okay, everything's cool for another year.